miss Ryan so much. Ryan not only helped to organize this, but he put together the PowerPoint presentation based on images and text from my website where I posted this presentation, which is a presentation that I gave at Creating Change in Minneapolis back in February when it was about zero. And Dennis came, and who else was there? And Jason were there. And after I gave this presentation, they said, oh, well, you should do this for Gapimny. And I said, I'd be happy to. At Creating Change, we organized the first ever A&PI Institute. If any of you have been to NGLTF's Creating Change, it's sort of a big queer activist conference of the year, and it moves around every year, and this year it was in Minneapolis. As part of the Institute, I gave this presentation, which is really, it takes a minimum of a half an hour to give, and I had about 10 minutes, so very fast, sort of like, you know, when you play a CD too fast or something like that on the wrong speed. So this time, fortunately, we'll have a lot more time, and I want to make it as interactive as possible. The work of Alicia goes on. And thanks, Alicia, for having me, and thanks, Gapimny. I'd like to make this as interactive and conversational as possible, so feel free to ask questions as I go along. Most of this is probably going to be new to you just because when people talk about LGBT history, APIs are pretty much forgotten. When people do Asian or Pacific Islander history or Asian American history, there's no LGBT queer element to it. So there's kind of a double erasure. And there are very few people who do this. I don't consider myself a historian or a scholar or anything like that, or an expert on this. But I think I feel it's very important that we know our history, that we know that we have one. How many of you have ever taken a course where you had a segment on material on queer API history? Zero. Oh, sort of?
No, never mind.
Well, Stephanie now teaches, so she can actually include it. Did you have a course on?
We had a course on Asian American studies, and it focused a little bit on more recent Asian American issues, which sort of explored the Details magazine issues with gay or Asianism, as well as the activism around that, and also the activism that was present in the queer gay community around the site.
Great. The last 25 years, and that's a very important history, and Gapimny now is 25 years old. But in terms of pre-modern history, meaning before the 19th century, very few people talk about it. There are a few scattered journal articles, which, you know, reach an audience of, you know, 200 or 300 people. In the queer API community, very few people either talk about it or know about it. So I thought it would be a really good occasion to acquaint ourselves with aspects of our history. So why this rather elaborate word, which Dennis asked me to explain again? I kind of invented it, because what I wanted to do, everyone knows what homoerotic is. I invented proto-transgender as a word because to call it transgender history would suggest the people that we're talking about are just like contemporary transgender people. And I want to avoid the mistake of reading ourselves back into history as if people that we might call LGBT are just like us, because there are clear differences. On the other hand, I wanted to suggest that there were people in pre-modern Asian and Pacific Islander societies who were like us in some significant respects. This goes in some ways to the debate between essentialists and constructionists. How many of you are familiar with that debate? Ryan, can you summarize, like in a sentence, what that debate was all about, what the essentialist position is and the constructionist position?
I mean, in constructionism, it's basically like the idea of how the binary things of how like, things are is usually seen from like, either like this or that. So a lot of anthropological like frameworks come from like the deep like structuralist framework where it's like they try to like see like, you know, part of the other.
Yeah, it's a big part of it. Essentialists stress continuities and suggest that there is a queer history. They generally focus on the gay part of it. And so you have books like Famous Homosexuals in History. But the risk of that approach is really to exaggerate the continuity and to suggest that people in the past were just like us, or that we're just like them. As if, you know, Leonardo da Vinci was just another Chelsea boy. but in fact, there are clear discontinuities, and contemporary LGBT identities are quite distinct in their own way from pre-modern identity formations. On the other hand, while I'm a social constructionist, we can take that too far in the opposite direction and exaggerate discontinuity to suggest that, as some people might say, oh, homosexuality was invented in 1888 or something like that. When, of course, obviously there have been people who have engaged in certain sex acts, you know, since there were bodies that were capable of doing that. So an extreme social constructionism, to my mind, exaggerates the discontinuity. So my approach, which you might call kind of moderate social constructionism, is to suggest that while there's no essential homosexuality or transgender, which is unvarying across different time periods and cultures, there are parallels and some points of continuity, so that we can actually discover that there were people who were like us in some significant ways, even if there are also significant differences as well. So that's why I invented the term proto-transgender, meaning anticipating contemporary transgender identities and practices. Does that make sense? Okay, so, and I also produced some images. This one, I just thought I'd throw up there just because most of you have probably seen Farewell My Concubine. How many of you have seen Farewell My Concubine? About half of us. It was a huge hit when it came out. It starred Leslie Cheung, who is a gay Hong Konger who unfortunately committed suicide a few years after this film was made. But it was a nominee for the Academy Award for Best Foreign Film. And unfortunately, it lost out to an extremely obscure film that no one has ever talked about since. So, but I believe this was the first film with a, you might call, queer API focus that was nominated for an Academy Award. I think that's right. Okay, so, I think I've been trained on it, right? It's my trainer over there. Sure. So, let me see if this works. Oh, wait. I think I just turned it off. Okay. That's a very short training. okay. So, and this is what I was talking about before. And I think it's very important when we talk about our visibility as queer APIs, both in the white dominant LGBT community, we face invisibility, stereotyping, as in the details, gay or Asian thing, and also in API communities where we face invisibility and erasure as LGBT queer folk. Okay. So, our first image, I found most of these online, actually all of them. And this is, I think it's really kind of amusing. So, these are two men or male figures, and there's a woman sort of peering behind a curtain. It's a very Red Lantern or something. And they're, you know, getting up to hijinks here. this is from an 18th century Qing Dynasty print. Now, what is interesting about the Qing Dynasty in the 18th century? What great significant thing happened as far as queer folk? Before the Qing Dynasty, homosexuality was not prohibited by law, and it was only made illegal in China under the Qing legal code. So the whole notion that homosexuality was somehow forbidden by law going back to time immemorial is simply not true. It was not even referenced in any direct way, in at least Chinese law, until the 18th century. Okay, so let's start with China, and we'll work our way around the great continent. I wanted to make this as inclusive as possible and include images from East Asian, South Asian, and Southeast Asian cultures, as well as Pacific Islander cultures. But there is just, frankly, a lot more on East Asian cultures and on male homosexuality as opposed to lesbianism, bisexuality, or transgender. That's just where the research has been done. Okay, so there are many traditions. How many of you have heard of the cut sleeve? A few people. And you might know that that's actually the term that Chinese use to this day as a euphemism for homosexuality. And it comes from a very interesting story. The Emperor Ai of the Han Dynasty, which was the first great dynasty in Chinese history, about 27 BC to 1 AD, he had a young lover, Deng Shen. And does anyone know the story of the cut sleeve? It's a great story. Charlie, do you know how?
No, I can't retell.
It's a great story. So you know that in Imperial China, yellow was the color of the emperor, and it was actually the capital offense to wear yellow if you were emperor. And the emperor would wear these long robes with long sleeves. And so the Emperor Ai had this favorite young lover, and they were enjoying some afternoon delight. and the emperor had to go off to some meeting with his ministers of state. Rather than wake his beloved, he took a pair of scissors and cut around this boy's head, cut the sleeve up, and went to the cabinet meeting with his ministers, and they were shocked. They said, "What happened to your sleeve?" And that's the origin of the term cut sleeve. And it's an important term just because the story behind it shows that homosexuality and homoerotic relations have been a part of Chinese history going back 2,000 years. And so when you hear Chinese or other Asians say, and you know, you can hear Chinese or Chinese Americans say, "Oh, we didn't have homosexuality until the British brought it in the 19th century." It's obviously absurd, because why do people use the term cut sleeve? There was a book by Brett Hinch called The Passion of the Cut Sleeve. It was a little bit controversial. Some people have accused him of plagiarism and using secondary sources, so there was this big dust-up in the pages of the Journal of Asian Studies, which is a leading journal of Asian studies. But if you don't regularly read these, you know, academic journals, you wouldn't know it. But in any case, there's a book called Passions of the Cut Sleeve by Brett Hinch. And so in Chinese, I guess it's Duan Chu. I think I pronounced that. There's another story. My other favorite story is about the half-eaten peach. It all comes back to fruit somehow. Yu Chao. This is a story of a nobleman named Li Mingwei during the Zhou Dynasty, and this goes back, you know, 400 years BC, who had a young lover named Li Zixia, and they were out rowing in a little rowboat in a pond, and the duke offered a peach to his lover.